おはようございます。皆さん、月曜日です。なんか今日はちょっと日本語で話そうかなと思って、まあそうしようか。
コーヒー。
じゃあ今日の質問した人は Lindsay Shorten。 彼女は Hey Robin, thanks so much for your daily videos. They are fab. ありがとう。 I have a question. What makes you decide where you'd like to live?Do you just follow job opportunities, or do you make a conscious decision based on the language you're learning at the time, for example? と質問した。
そうだね、なんかこれはすごく面白い質問だと思うね。まあどうやって答えるかな。
一般的にね、他の国に住みに行く前にその外国語を習うね。例えば日本の場合は、まあ日本でいろんなことがあったでしょ。例えばなんか通訳者の仕事、それから大学生だった、まあ留学生、その時喫茶店でバリスタというなんかバイトをやったね。でも日本に行く前にまあ3年間ぐらい日本語をいっぱい勉強したね。確かに日本とか日本人とか日本語、確かになんかものすごく面白かった私にね。その理由で本当に日本に住みに行きたかった。Et c'était la même chose avec le français. J'ai essayé plusieurs fois de vivre en France. Je pense que c'était deux ou trois fois que j'ai essayé de me faire une vie en France. Et j'ai pas réussi. Mais par exemple, en 2014, j'étais déjà retourné en Angleterre après d'avoir diplômé de l'université aux États-Unis. J'étais réceptionniste en Angleterre, et pendant toute cette époque de ma vie, j'avais un grand intérêt dans le français, la France. C'était vraiment quelque chose, j'étais énamoré vraiment de l'idée de vivre en France. Et donc je suis allé à Paris et j'ai essayé de me faire une vie à Paris en France. Ça a duré trois semaines et demie, et je n'avais plus rien, et je me suis trouvé de nouveau aux États-Unis où j'ai diplômé de l'université. So in these first cases, there was certainly a massive language component to why I went to go live in different countries. It's a bit difficult for me to completely separate sort of the language of a place and just so many other components. I tend to become really fascinated by the people that live there and so many aspects of the cultural fabric. It really does start to become this huge thing, but it does often begin with the language. So Japanese, definitely, it started with an interest in the language, and then over 3 years of really intensely studying, not just Japan, but Japanese people, and of course the language, falling in love with kanji, Chinese characters, I had to go and live there, and I had this kind of obsession with wanting to have a really authentic experience of life there, and that's why I eventually got a job as an interpreter. That's why I got a job in a cafe to work in the service industry in Japan, which was probably one of the hardest things I've ever done. With France, I was kind of like enamored by this idea, this dream of living there, because when I was a kid, a lot of my really fun memories were going to France on vacation. And then I had been studying French finally, and I'd fallen in love with French literature and French cinema and all these different things. And so, and of course, it's Paris, you know, it was this romantic idea of going to live there and speak French every day. And so that drove me to go and seek out opportunities in Paris. Now, depending on your criteria for living somewhere, I've actually lived in 9 countries, and some of those multiple times. So after that, I ended up back in the US, and this is where living in different countries was very much driven by job opportunities. The entire time, the whole theme was really just me trying to find a place to call home. That's really what the origins of my documentary were. I was just trying to find this feeling of home, a place to kind of belong and stay. I didn't want to move around here and there and there. I never imagined I would move countries like 15 times in 5 or 6 years. It was crazy. So I really wanted to return to Europe, and I still had this dream of living in France at the time. And I got an opportunity to go and teach French at a school in the Netherlands. And so, long story short, I spent 2 of the most intense months I can remember trying to learn Dutch so I could go and take this job opportunity to teach French in a Dutch school.
I have to say, this was the beginning of the period of my language learning career where I started to learn languages extremely quickly. And so my first day in the Netherlands, I actually had to go and do a job interview with a school principal in Dutch, and he was not letting me speak any English. And then I had to speak to 3 classes in Dutch. That was literally, I think, one of the hardest days of my life. It was the feeling of drowning in like words, but like I had one nostril above the water, and I don't know how I survived that day, but I did. And they did offer me the job. But the problem is, there was a huge misunderstanding and they no longer were able to offer me full-time hours, so it wasn't feasible for me. So like, then I ended up wandering around the Netherlands for a month trying to find a job, and I realized, what am I doing? I really want to live in France. And so I went to Lille in the north of France and I was couch surfing for a whole month. So again, in this case, my choice to go live there was very much tied to my love for the language and just the country overall. So after a month of unsuccessfully searching for a job, sleeping on people's couches, all kinds of stuff, I finally accepted a job to go and live in Lisbon, Portugal, as a French customer service agent. From the moment I decided to take the phone call to the moment I actually found myself sitting in Lisbon, Portugal, waiting to start my new job, was about 36 hours. It was insane. E o português é muito interessante para mim, porque foi a primeira vez que me mudei para país sem falar o idioma. Foi muito difícil para mim, não falava português. E a coisa interessante é que eu aprendi muito mais português depois de viver em Portugal. E agora eu falo português do Brasil. But yeah, so that was really interesting. I went to go live in Portugal. And again, this was really more about just trying to survive. I just wanted a job and needed a way to survive and hopefully live somewhere nice. But in Portugal, I was earning very, very little money, and I was actually starting to lose money, and I had almost no money left. And so it's hard to explain how I came to this decision, but I decided that the best decision for finding a more stable life was to go live in Germany, because I had like one contact there who I knew. I did not speak German at the time, and this was the fastest I ever acquired a new language. Now, I had previously learned quite a bit of Dutch, but by this point I had actually forgotten most of it, just for context. But within 6 weeks, I actually became able to function in German well enough to go and live there and to do everything in bad German. Now, it's honestly a crazy story how this happened. I'd love to tell you this story if you're interested. But I got a job for IBM in Germany, so I quit my job. 3 days before my flight to Germany, IBM canceled my new job because they had some kind of disaster and they needed to cancel it. So I had a flight to Leipzig, Germany with no job, nowhere to live. I was freaking out. When all of a sudden I got this like dream job opportunity to work for a fashion startup in Hamburg to work as a international public relations writer. So again, in this case, there was certainly a huge language interest. I had always wanted to learn German, but the driving force of deciding to go live in Germany was still this sort of just necessity of trying to survive, trying to find myself a nice situation in a nice country with a language that I liked, and to just find a place to call home. Now, after 2 months living in Hamburg, that startup went like bankrupt and lost their biggest investor. And then I found myself back in the United States again. And that's the moment where I actually started my own business. I was really exhausted from, you know, I had all these language skills. By this time, I really did speak about 8 languages pretty well. I had all kinds of other skills like video production. I was so interested in education. And I just got really tired of not fitting into anybody's mold. I had all these different skills, but I didn't have like a complete package that anybody wanted. And so I was constantly moving to different countries, always at the mercy of whatever job opportunity I could find. So I started my own business. I started teaching languages. I was also doing translation and basically doing anything I could language related to earn myself a living. And from then on, I went to live in several different countries. I lived in Italy, I lived in Spain, lived in Canada. that was a very interesting story. I moved to Montreal because I was actually dating a girl in Montreal, and I went to go and live with a Vietnamese family there. So I actually learned a bunch of Vietnamese. Of course, Montreal is French and English speaking, so I got to speak French. So that was the case where I moved across the world from Barcelona, Spain to Montreal, Canada for a relationship that I was in. But by and large, the rest of the countries I lived in during that period, I was mostly definitely driven by languages that I had been learning, languages that I spoke, but primarily I just wanted to find a home. And then the last phase of this response is obviously now I live in the San Francisco Bay Area. And that was definitely driven more by professional opportunities. So after I published my first book and launched my first website, I actually became kind of homeless again. I have a video on this channel that I made about that. But I had learned how to build software, and I was building not just simple websites, I was already working on Journaly, I was building a lot of stuff. And it was actually my YouTube audience that was telling me, what are you doing? Like, you should not be starving. You should not be homeless. It's been like 6 years of this. You need to go and utilize your software development skills and earn a nice living. And that was the first time I'd ever considered working as a software developer. I tried, but nobody was interested in me over in North Carolina because I didn't have any formal education for those skills. I didn't even have a boot camp. I had nothing except just the skills inside of me and my experience trying to build stuff. And so that's the moment when, for the first time, I thought San Francisco, it just seemed like a place where someone like me could succeed. It seemed like a place where people might actually give me a chance purely based on my skills and not based on my academic merits. And like 3 weeks later, I got my first software engineering job in San Francisco, and I've now been here for almost 2 years. Thank you very much for that question, Lindsay. I hope you all enjoyed this. I know that it wasn't super tied to language learning, but I think that languages were an absolutely core component of not just why I lived in different countries, but also it enabled me. It gave me the ability to live in a lot of different places and get a lot of different experiences doing a lot of different things. And I'm really, really happy that I've now managed to create a life where I can have an apartment and pay rent and not be like borderline homeless all the time, but still get to continue with all of my language learning projects, which is really where my deepest passion lies. Okay, everybody, I hope that inspires you to go out and at least learn something today with your languages or anything else. I wish you a wonderful Monday, and I'll see you tomorrow.